Hello everyone, we'll be starting with our today's topic, that is surgical management of hernia. So there are three main types of surgical management of hernia, that is herniotomy, herniography and hernioplasty. We'll be talking about each one of them in detail. Starting with herniotomy. So herniotomy is not usually done now. It is only done for congenital hernias. So, what do we do in this procedure? In this procedure, we identify the sac and push the contents inside. And if the sac was opened, we close the sac and the defect remains as it is. That means we do not suture it, we do not put a mesh around it. So, what happens if we do not cover this defect? So, because of this, there is highest recurrence rate in this method. Now, I already told you that it is a treatment of choice for congenital inguinal hernia, congenital hydrocele and inguinal hernia in children. Now, talking about the second procedure, that is herniography. So, in herniography, the step 1, step 2 is same as herniotomy. That means you identify the sac, push the contents inside and if the sac was open, you close it. Now, the third step that changes is you suture the two ends together. That means these two ends, you use a suture material and suture them together. So what happens in this? See, when a defect is this small and you suture it, it's fine. But when a defect is large and you suture it, that means you're causing these two ends to come together and that increases the tension. So what does it mean by increasing the tension? So if it increases the tension, that means the sutures can slip through the sutured part. So there is most common cause of failure, that is increased tension. So there's chances of failure in this method. Now example of this method is 3, Bassinis, Scholdes and Mayo. Bassini and Scholde is used in inguinal hernia. We'll talk about it later. Indications of herniography is infected or strangulated hernia. So if you have infected or strangulated hernia, you will go for this method. Now the third method is hernioplasty. In hernioplasty, the first and second step is same. This third step, you do not suture it, you put a mesh over the defect. Now what does mesh do? Mesh, it covers a defect without creating tension. So it has least recurrence and tension-free repair. Example is Leichenstein tension-free mesh hernioplasty. It is used in inguinal hernia. Now talking about mesh. So mesh can be of two types, synthetic and biological. So synthetic mesh is avoided when we are talking about infected and strangulated hernia. But the biological mesh can be used here. But one thing we need to note, that in biological mesh, when there is infection or strangulation, there is an enzyme release, that is collagenase. So this collagenase, it can also destroy the biological mesh, so it can fail. So you need to know that, but still we can use the biological one, but we cannot use the synthetic one in the infected and strangulated hernia. So examples of synthetic one are proline mesh, polyester mesh, Wipro and PTFE. Of biological, acellular human dermis, that is alloderm, and acellular porcine dermis. Now you need to know that in acellular dermis, there are no pores in the mesh. You can see there are no pores in the mesh, whereas in the synthetic mesh, you can see that there are pores. It's porous. Now, the synthetic mesh can be solid or net mesh. Solid, by solid mesh, I say that it can be of this type. That means there are no holes. And by net mesh, I say this type. That means if you're talking about solid mesh, since it has no holes, you need to fix them with suture or stapler. Whereas net mesh, since it has pores, the fibrous tissue can grow through these pores and it can remain in place without sutures and staplers. That means if this is a mesh and it has holes, the fibrous tissue will come out. So it is better anchored. You do not need sutures or staples. Now, talking about the material. So in material, we have the most common one is proline. It's strong and hydrophobic. It's hydrophobic, that means it is scared of water, so it will prevent infection. Polyester, the disadvantage is that it is hydrophilic, so there's increased risk of infection. But the protective thing is rapid tissue ingrowth. So the rapid tissue ingrowth, the cellular defense mechanism, help in preventing infection. Now, the PTFE. This is a solid mesh. So, the advantage is that it does not become adherent to tissue. Less chances of fistula formation. IPOM is intraperitoneal placement of mesh. You place it intraperitoneally. Now, what is fenestrated PTFE mesh? So, PTFE mesh was a solid mesh, but the fenestrated PTFE mesh, so the peritoneum will grow through the pores, but the bowel will not become adherent. So, the advantage I already told you is that does not become adherent to tissue. That is what we are talking about here, that the bowel will not become adherent and the peritoneum will grow, so it will have a good adherence. Now, an important characteristic thing about mesh is that it shrinks. So if it shrinks, that is up to 50%, if it shrinks, there is chances of reoccurrence. And when the mesh shrinks, there is pain due to shrinkage. Now, what you need to remember is that if a defect is this small, you need to use a mesh that is this big. That means 5 cm. Why? Because we know that the mesh shrinks. Because of the shrinkage, this can lead to failure. So what we need to make sure is that the mesh, even after shrinkage, covers the defect completely. So after shrinkage, if the mesh is this much, it is covering the defect. That means the procedure is a success. So a large mesh should be used, at least 5 cm overlap on the site of placement. Now, weight of the mesh, this is not that important, but still, there are two types, low weight and heavy weight, less than 40 grams per meter square and more than 80 grams per meter square. And this is just one property, that heavier the mesh, more is the shrinkage. So now if we have learned all these properties, so what do we call an ideal mesh or the best mesh? Is the one with low weight, thin fibers and large pores. This is comfortable and there's less shrinkage. Now, there's another type of mesh that's called plug mesh. So imagine this is a defect. The plug mesh is plugged like this. So the disadvantage here is that there can be increased collagen deposition that can cause meshoma. And this meshoma can also cause nerve entrapment, which can lead to pain. This was about the general surgical management of hernia. Moving on to the inguinal hernia and its management. So, inguinal hernia is most common hernia in male and females. Indirect inguinal hernia, which is more common in inguinal hernia. The management can be of two types, open or laparoscopic. We'll be talking about open first. So, in open, we have three procedures, herniotomy, herniography, and hernioplasty. So, herniotomy, we already know that we do it in congenital situations. Herniography, I told you that we have Bassanese and we have Scholdes. In Bassanese, the suture conjoint tendon with reflected portion of inguinal ligament. In Scholdes, there are three steps. So what are the three steps? The first step is double breasting of fascia transversalis. Now what is double breasting? So if this is a defect and if I take one layer of, for example, fascia transversalis, I'll put one layer like this and the other layer like this. So this is called double breasting. So I'm protecting the defect by two layers of each section. As in each, for fascia transversalis, there'll be total two layers. So it's also called six layered. So the first layer, double breasting with fascia transversalis. The second is double breasting with conjoint tendon with reflected inguinal ligament. Now, this is similar to the Bassanese. It corresponds to the Bassanese repair because in Bassanese also we suture the conjoint tendon with the reflected portion of inguinal ligament. The third one is double breasting of external oblique aponeurosis. So the three layers are fascia transversalis, conjoint tendon with reflected inguinal ligament and external oblique aponeurosis. The surgery of choice is Leichenstein's tendon free mesh hernioplasty. Now, the complications that you can face in open inguinal hernia are, first is hemorrhage, injury to vas deferens or cord structures. Now, there are two important points. The most common nerve injured during the open surgery and the most common nerve entrapped. So, injured when we open the deep inguinal ring, we can injure ilium inguinal nerve. So this is the most common nerve injured during open surgery. The most common nerve entrapped beneath the mesh is iliohypogastric nerve, and this causes chronic inguinal pain. So the injured one is ilioinguinal and the entrapped one is iliohypogastric nerve. There are chances of recurrence and wound infection. Now, Stopa's repair is an open preperitoneal repair. It forms the basis for laparoscopic TAP. Now, what is TAP? So, moving on to the laparoscopic surgery, there are of two types, TEP and TAP. TEP is total extraperitoneal repair. TAP is transabdominal preperitoneal repair. So the difference is, in extraperitoneal, you do not breach the peritoneum. The surgery is done above the peritoneum. It is better repair and more challenging. The transabdominal preperitoneal repair is done beneath the peritoneum and hence breached. The photos you can see clearly. This is TEP, total extraperitoneal. So the instruments are placed above the peritoneum. You are not breaching the peritoneum. In this one, that is TAP, what you do is you take it inside. So the peritoneum is this layer. You are taking it inside the peritoneum. Now, laparoscopic repair is specially used for bilateral inguinal hernia and recurrent inguinal hernia. Now, moving on, you need to remember this thing that during the laparoscopic repair, two places where staples should not be applied are triangle of doom and triangle of pain. Now, we'll talk about the contents and boundaries here. So, you can see the triangle of doom, this one, and the triangle of pain is this one. So, this is the triangle of pain and this is the triangle of doom. The contents of triangle of doom are external iliac vein and external iliac artery and the genital branch of genitofemoral nerve. The contents of triangle of pain are lateral femoral cutaneous nerve, anterior femoral cutaneous nerve. This is variable, it may not be there. Femoral branch of genitofemoral nerve and femoral nerve. So these are the contents of triangle of pain and triangle of doom. Now, we already read in open surgery that the most common nerve entrapped in open surgery here we read was iliohypogastric nerve. But in the closed surgery, in the laparoscopic surgery, the most common nerve entrapped is lateral cutaneous nerve of thigh, that is present, this one, that is present in triangle of pain. So it causes myralgia paresthesia. Now you can see that the triangle of pain and triangle of doom form a trapezoid. So it's also known as trapezoid of disaster. Both of these together are called trapezoid of disaster. And one thing that you need to note during surgery is that triangle of pain is also known as electrical hazard zone, because if you use cautery or something here, it can lead to disastrous events. So that is it for today. Thank you.